Hi, good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Observer Research Foundation, Mumbai. Before we get started, could I ask all of you to please turn your mobiles on silent? So our topic today is India, China, and globalization, emerging superpowers, and the future of economic development. Our speaker this evening is an accomplished author and also happens to be a master's in development economics from Leicester University in England. She was a journalist with the Economic Times. And apart from authoring this particular book that she will be talking about, she's also authored two other books, The Economic Con Game in 2002 and Globalization and Sustainable Economic Development in 2013. Along with that, she happens to be an academic, a visiting lecturer at Xavier's. And when she finds the free time, apart from writing books and being an academic and an author, she also is interested in ballet. So we've got a very accomplished individual here to talk about this book. Our chair for this evening happens to be an eminent and very widely respected economist, Mr. Meenu Rustamji Shroff. He's had a storied and accomplished career spanning a plethora of positions across different departments and in academia and also in corporate affairs. He was with the Government of India as an economist and economic administrator. He was additional secretary banking at the Ministry of Finance, also professor of economics at IIM Ahmedabad, an editor at the Economic Times, and an advisor to the Unit Trust of India, apart from being on the boards of various corporate houses. The book this evening we're talking about, India, China, and Globalization, takes a holistic view of the global interdependence between economies while focusing specifically on two of the largest drivers of that economy, India and China. As one of the glowing reviews in Human Rights Consortium School of Advanced Study, University of London said, this book is succinct and yet thorough. It manages to capture the vast scope of globalization with a very fresh perspective, an area of literature that was long considered inundated with enough. We at the Observer Research Foundation are great proponents and believers of the future of the world with India and China. We've been spearheading a lot of initiatives recently, and many of the current government's initiatives, you'd be surprised to know, mirror a lot of things that we've been working on for the last few months. And some of those you will hear about in the near future. This is one of those events that spearheads the India-China partnership. And without any further ado, I'd like to hand it over to our chair for the evening, Mr. Shroff.
I have great interest in China. I was reading a booklet, a Forum of Free Enterprise of which I'm the president, China's Remarkable Economic Growth, Some Lessons, 20 years ago. And I was just trying to compare this evening as to how much has come true and how much has not. In fact, they have far exceeded it. The finest thing I heard the other day, very cryptic remark from a Chinese economist, difference between India and China. He says, China is a closed society, but it's an open mind. You Indians are one of the finest democracies in the world, but your mind is closed. When you meet them in close groups, partly Mr. Kulkarni had arranged over the years, I have also met and participated, and at the World Trade Center and so on, they'll tell you that, why are you chaps so fascinated with China? Figures are fine, but as far as the quality of intellect is concerned, particularly in banking, law professions, you are far ahead. The trouble with you guys is you don't run fast enough. And there are two interesting articles on China, one today and one earlier. And there's an Indian author who writes, why have they taken away the cake when we were at the same level? The point is that they knew that they were an agricultural country and they must start at the bottom. So first, of course, was the collective 20 years were pretty difficult, as you know, and then there was the Red Book, collectives, total uniformity, you couldn't speak, you couldn't do anything. Because China had also gone through a very difficult time. First was exploitation by the British, opium wars, then the Japanese. The country was split. A lot of money went away to Formosa. Look at Taiwan today. I was wondering as I coming here, where the hell did he get billions of dollars in gold? But look what they've done with Taiwan. That means the Chinese, like Indians, basically. You know, it's often said that about mid-18th century, India and China almost ruled the world in the sense we had 50% of the world's GNP. That they have made it, we hoped that we would get back to that stage. And if you see the differences between the statistic then and now, it's ridiculous. Today, China makes almost half of the world steel. I don't know what they do with it, but there you are. If you are in any business, shipping, cement, steel, any non-ferrous metal, the price is influenced by what China buys and stores. So the first intelligence in London, which is the heart of all this, is to guess what China is going to do next. It makes such a difference, not America. But it's a closed society. At the same time, they have very deliberately kept it because they've learned from the Russian experience that politically, once you open up, you know, the mistake Gorbachev made was to open up politically, marking before bread, and it totally misfired. China is way ahead of Russia today, whereas once it was almost a satellite. Now the problem is they do things intently. There's nothing they know which we don't. But everywhere they're five times our size. Now it's amazing with compounding. I was working out in my compound table today that if they've grown at 11%, as they say, for 30 years, and we grew at average of 5.5, 6, they're five times us, whether GDP, so in purchasing power parity, surprisingly, they're not five times, they're only 2.5 times. Now our ministers, without knowing the figures and anything, they said we are growing faster than China. Now look at, and it's like that 15 lakhs is coming to you. Take a simple $1,000, and take $300 in compound. Another thing is, if you take our population growth, they are growing at 0.7, 0.8. So there is a difference of 0.8 there. Now if you compound it with five times the base, how the hell are you ever going to catch up? And you see, we're running faster and faster than them. We are growing the fastest in the world. In per capita terms, certainly we are growing only at 1/5. Because with that base, with purchasing power parity, on almost $8,000 to $9,000 today, and if they're still growing at 7%, they are growing like something Europe was growing 20 years ago. And every parameter you see, whether it's growing of grains, look at infrastructure, power generation. Now, they are only 10 years lead over us. We started liberalization after that. But like this theory, it was a question of a song that if you catch the color of the red didn't matter as long as you caught it. And China has steadfastly gone ahead. I'll tell you an interesting story. When I was there, I wanted to be outside the official parameters and get a taxi driver who would take me to the areas in Beijing and Shanghai, which were not that urbanized then. It was not as bad as many of our outflowings, if you see between Bombay and Pune, even in those days. And we asked about anything compared to the Red Book and one child theory and so on and so forth. So this man, my guide, told me, he says, look, we have gone through hell. You cannot imagine today what we have gone through. When my son or my daughter asked me, he said, forget the past. All this, what is being done today, you will have a very bright future. Now, this was the sense of optimism even 20 years ago. And now there is nothing looking back. the largest manufacturer of motor cars today are the Japanese. Almost 10 million, because America has come down. You'd be surprised that I was told that when they started after liberation in 1950s, there were only 50 cars in Shanghai. Today they are making almost 1.5 million cars a month, which we were making 3 years ago. We are catching up, but you know the catch up. So the point is that having come here, communism is not of attraction to them. But it gives them a sense of power, position. Chinese never let anybody look down upon. Another thing is the uniform society. They're very proud of, like the Japanese, you know, they don't like any other community to beat them. They may be competitors domestically. Now, in terms of globalization, I don't want to trample on the ground, is about globalization. Even in 1995-96, when Mrs. Thatcher, I'll tell you very interesting, Mrs. Thatcher never loved the Japanese, and the Hong Kong issue came. And she was there when we were at the summit. Lee Kuan Yew and the world glitterati was there. And she was the last to speak. She got up and she said, look, everything has been said, governors, prime minister, but I am Maggie Thatcher. I'm no longer prime minister. And I'm paid a handsome sum for doing this. And I'm not known to keep quiet. She said, let me be very frank. When I started negotiating with the Chinese, I thought I could beat them down, you know, game of patience. So as a bait, playing bridge, he said, 50 years, take 50 years for you to come up to British levels. They started with 10. It's a matter of compromise. 25, 30 was almost agreed. She said, I'll eat my words today. I think they'll make it in 15, what I've seen. That's how they gallop. The Americans also, they have, as you know, a lot in common. They keep on doing shadow boxing. There's enormous amount of genuine interest. They know they can't fight a war themselves. They'll maintain each other's area of influence. Let's look at the currency. They've got $4 trillion as reserves. America hardly has 100. They don't care because they print notes. And dollar is still a going currency. 60% of world's trade is done in dollars. Bonds are still 65-70%. All commodities are done. Why are the Chinese not forcing their way? They're doing it at the margin. Because they're a very close society. They've learned from the Asian crisis what can happen. See, when you talk of America or West, the question is they've got very deep, ingrained institutions, a lot of tradition. The markets are deep. People believe in the currency. There's a lot of stability politically. American presidents and go. The system is not shaken up. They may grow at 4% or 3%, but that base has been created. China is not yet that sure. And it's created a lot of enemies also. See, politically, all the Chinese-bred people who are looking up China as the model, they are now scared of it. I'm talking of more the yellow races, you can say. I don't know even whether North Korea is that much in love. Russia, love and hate. Philippines, because they're scared of the size. Otherwise, they would certainly roll up their sleeves. So it's feeling that at the end of the day, and now India is trying to flex his muscles away in the South India Sea and so on and so forth. So there is a big problem of whether he should take a globalized role. But I think in the IMF, they're pushing their way in. But there's one thing which many of you may not aware. China became an original member of the world institutions because the old Chiang Kai-shek, and fact is China and America were very close allies during the war. So after the war, when this institution, and they've got that, and they're keeping India out. The biggest antagonistic of what Indian delegates tell me is China. They've never said ever that they would like to promote. They said, don't mind it. So everywhere, it seems they feel that India is the only rising sun which could come up to them a few years hence. So globalization is a problem. Why is it not becoming international currency? Their largest investments in America. So they know where their interests are. $1.5 trillion are in US treasuries. People say if they were to withdraw, the US financial system will collapse. But what would become to China's treasury receipts? They'll come down to 1/3 or half its value. So America also has a hold on it. So these are very many pluses, minuses going. But I think as far as India and China is concerned, at least there is a certain opening up now. And China is now coming to recognize that India is not that much of a competitor. And if it takes it along, it's not going to overtake it. It's for India to do the running, not China. And we got to slowly step up. Lastly, about the border. I was in Dubai, and our chief air marshal, a Parsi gentleman, Mr. Major, was there with me in the conference. We were talking about India's preparedness. And one thing was reassuring. He said, whatever you may read about ammunition and tongues and so on, as far as the Air Force is concerned and logistics, we seem to have built up quite a bit. We can resist. We are not going to buckle in. So it's not that much frightening situation. The Chinese know that. That's why they are also recruiting. So I think that's a reassuring thing, and the otherwise also a bit. But the fact is they are so sure and cocky, I think, that they are galloping ahead. We are still jogging. I think with Modi coming, he has realized, this is the right way to go, because you can't overcome them. They quite tend to keep on stalling them and see whether they don't hurt us. I'll leave now the floor to Piya. Come.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming. And I hope you all will enjoy the presentation. I'm going to make this presentation, which is titled India, China, and Globalization. And as I go along, I'll elaborate on certain important points. I'll also be reading excerpts from my book, which was mentioned. So enjoy listening. Thank you. How long do I speak? Can you all hear me? Yeah. One of the most, I think, damaging misconceptions of contemporary times, of current times, is the assumption that we evaluate economic prospects merely on the basis of how fast a country is growing, the rate at which a country is growing. And this misconception translates into us as in citizens, even economists, even finance experts, with due respect, when we merely look at one aspect of economics, we also tend to make forecasts and judgments that, in a sense, are half-baked. And judging economic prospects and assuming that if a country grew at 9% or 10%, it would be enough to transform that particular country, I think that actually set me thinking. And that was the reason that I started writing my first book. And the exercise has continued. Economic prospects, and especially in the current, y'all probably would have read that over the last 2-3 months with the IMF and the World Bank and probably some other financial institutions talking about fairly subdued growth rates in the advanced countries, a slowing down of growth rates in the developing countries. And it gets people to wonder, so then what would the implications for economic progress be? How would countries progress if growth rates are going to be so subdued? And I'd like to say that subdued growth rates does not have to translate into a subdued pace of development. Now, the three aspects that my presentation will focus on is the next transition. The second one is development-led globalization, and the third one is India-China, and the main issues, the main macroeconomic issues. Now, by no means, and I'm going to promise that this is going to be an exhaustive presentation, I'm sure a number of important aspects would be left out, because for that you need a series of presentations. But what this would try and do is communicate some important pointers about lessons of the economic experience that we have so far, lessons that have emerged from the crisis, lessons looking at the economic experience of the developed and the developing world, what this means for future strategies, what this generally means for the world, and how is the world equipped at this point in time to face the challenges that it is confronted with. But this would generally be the thrust of my presentation. As I mentioned, the fundamental questions arise about what would the prospect for economic progress in the world economy, what would that prospect be determined by? What would the prospects actually be influenced by? What are the variables that we have to look at? And there are three important factors here. One is the present imbalances in the global financial system. The other is the income and non-income disparities. The third is the slowdown in investment and the lack of employment generation in the world economy over the last few years. Now, these are the three important aspects that will actually determine economic progress over the next decade. Now, let us just look at this a little intuitively and a little analytically. What do I mean when I say imbalances in the global financial system? The basic imbalance is this, that in spite of there being the problem that we face today is not as a result of the lack of capital. We have to, if any of us think that the current problems is a result of the lack of capital, that is a misconception. The problem is essentially connected with allocation. The problem is connected with demand and supply mismatches which persist. So in spite of there being potentially a number of investment opportunities in the emerging markets, even in parts of the developed world, the capital that is there, the capital that is available, doesn't get to these various spheres of economic activity. So, for example, we have infrastructure, huge investment opportunity, running into trillions of dollars. And you have enough capital to be able to fund this infrastructure, to be able to get into infrastructure as an investment. But somehow the most productive investment opportunities have not been harnessed enough. You don't have capital getting into the most productive investment areas. And this is the basic deficiency of the financial system. Because when you look at capital and you speak of productive investment and you speak of earning a return, the most productive investment essentially is capacity building. You build capacity, you build infrastructure capacity, you build educational capacity, you build skill development capacity, and that is something that has not been done adequately. And therefore, when you're talking about imbalances, one imbalance essentially is this imbalance between the amount of capital that is available and the amount of capital that is needed. And what is available doesn't get to the points where it's needed maximum. That's the first point. The second point, income and non-income disparities. Income inequality matters. It matters, I'm not saying this from an ideological standpoint. There is, of course, a huge humanitarian perspective when we are looking at inequality. And that humanitarian perspective, 20 years back, if I 20 years back, I wasn't old enough to speak about it, but 20 years back, if an economist spoke about inequalities of income, he'd probably be told, well, that's inevitable in the process of development. Now, be that as it may, the point is that the income disparities that the world is actually characterized by at this point in time, you've never had income disparities of that extent and magnitude for the last 100 years. I was reading this article which said that, you know, the income inequalities that we witness today, you had something similar to that just before the First World War. And, you know, Oxfam brings out this report about income inequalities, and it says that, you know, you have 1% of the world's population, 1 or 2% of the world's population, controlling 50% of the world's resource. Now, what happens is, when you have this kind of inequality and this kind of limited access to basic means of sustenance, housing, food, basic education, it translates into generations which are denied, generations which are shut out from the market, generations which are shut out from productive participation in the labor market, generations which get a wage below minimum wage. So all this employment that you see in the unorganized sector, and according to the ILO, you have about 1.2 billion people working in the unorganized sector and earning a wage which is either just about equal to the minimum wage or below the minimum wage. What does this ultimately translate into? Limited capacity, limited incomes, unrealized potential, and that particular point at which development has come to a standstill. That particular point at which growth has just not, the benefits of growth have just not reached. And in order, therefore, for per capita incomes to expand across sectors and across socioeconomic categories, and in order for markets to actually expand, in order for employment to be generated, you know, we speak about the demographic dividend of India, and that demographic dividend needs to get education, it needs to get employment opportunities. And this will happen if this disparity is addressed, if access is expanded. Connected to this is a slowdown in investment. There is a huge connect between the inequalities of income that we see and the kind of investment that we have not seen. Because, as I mentioned, when you have so many people just about, you know, below the poverty line or on the poverty line, remaining with difficulty on the poverty line, all those individuals are individuals who, if they had better jobs, if they had better prospects, if they had a higher income, that would translate into high levels of purchasing power, that would translate into a better investment outlook, and that would once again translate into better incomes, and then you would have a virtuous cycle of investment. So when you talk about income inequalities and you talk about investment revival, the two are connected. In India, it's extremely clear that the biggest growth stimulus would come from the expansion of infrastructure. And that would definitely lead to an expansion of employment, which again would feed back into the investment cycle. Because an expansion of employment would simply mean increase in demand. So these three factors will determine prospects in the global economy moving forward. The three factors that I mentioned, the three challenges basically that confront, the three fundamental challenges that confront the global economy, these three factors existed even before the crisis of 2008. And these three factors have led to a situation that Christine Lagarde of the IMF says is what we are looking at, the new normal. And essentially the new normal is that the world will grow at a level, the rate of growth on an average in the global economy would be far below it has been for a long time. It would certainly be far below the rate of growth that the world enjoyed before the crisis. Should that alarm us? Not really. Not really at this point, because the world is recovering. And there is another more important factor, which is that when you had such high growth rates from 2000 and 2008, you had a number of countries, developing and developed, that grew at a fairly significant pace. What did it do for the essential parameters in so far as development is concerned? What did it do in so far as progress is concerned? And with the exception of China, really, and with the exception of some countries of Southeast Asia, not many countries have seen rapid levels of economic progress, even between 2000 and 2008. This was the period when growth rates were really high. So if really high growth rates do not remedy, was not able to remedy underdevelopment, we should not expect, we should not be sure that nominal levels of growth rate or low levels of economic growth rate should prevent development. Certainly, there's much more to the development story. Certainly, there's much more to the economic progress story than growth. And therefore, what has happened today, what the world faces today, is, as I told you all, the result of these three factors playing out. And therefore, the new normal refers to this trend of lower growth rates for the global economy. Now, I'm sure most of us are familiar with this, that for most emerging markets, what has happened is that they were impacted also by the crisis, and particularly a number of emerging markets are dependent on exports. And when the world economy went into a slump, exports declined. These countries also faced a certain amount of volatility, and therefore, a number of these countries are not very healthy in fiscal terms. They have large fiscal deficits. There was a temporary relief because of the downtrend in oil prices, but they cannot depend on that, because at some point we've already seen oil prices increase. And of course, moving on, India and China have both benefited from this decline in oil prices. And so far as other emerging markets are concerned, we find that they're not going to grow, as I mentioned, at more than 6 to 6.5%. There are, of course, geopolitical risks. We know Middle East, Ukraine, parts of Africa. That will also add to the volatility. One important point that I'd like to mention is that what we see today, the outcomes that we see today, and which are very often attributed to the recession of 2008, that these outcomes were in the making much before the crisis. As I mentioned to you all, between 2000 and 2008, you had extremely rapid growth rates, and yet the pace of development, the pace of economic progress in most developing countries and even in certain parts of the developed world was rather tepid. It was rather slow, with the exception of China. So definitely the factors that have confronted, the challenges that confront the world today may have been aggravated by the crisis, but certainly to say that it is the crisis alone that has caused those challenges, that would be an extremely erroneous presumption. The crisis was the result of unaddressed issues. And these unaddressed issues also, one of the outcomes of these unaddressed issues has been that you have this, some economists say, secular stagnation. Translated in simple English, what it means is you have this downtrend where countries are not going to grow. It is forecasted that until 2020, you're not going to have very impressive growth performance. And therefore, when I say potential I think in the previous one when I said I think I use the word potential output somewhere. What is meant by potential output is that the capacity of countries to grow after the crisis, the capacity of countries to grow is far lower than it was before the crisis. But the result, the reasons for this lie not only in the recession. The reasons for this essentially lies, as I will be explaining later, in the manner in which capital was handled, in the manner in which capital was allocated. Now, this management of capital and what it really implies is called economic management, which I'll deal a little later, but for now. Therefore, as I was explaining to you all, slow pace of economic progress does not mean we should not assume that just because countries are growing at a slower rate of growth, or a slower pace of economic progress, that would be unsustainable or that would be shallow. And neither does a higher economic growth always result in development. It doesn't. This I mentioned to you, where will new markets emerge from? An expansion of per capita income. More than 1 billion people in the world live on less than a dollar a day. 2.7 billion struggle to survive on less than $2. Now, with these kind of statistics, and that's what I told you, that the fundamental challenges, the three challenges, and I mentioned the imbalances and the non-income and income disparities, how can you expect to expand markets when you have a huge chunk of humanity almost shut out from participating in the market? Competitiveness in terms of cutting wage costs. I said, but ultimately when we are talking of competitiveness and we are talking of investment, it's ultimately linked to the expansion of markets. How will this expansion of markets be fueled? So unless you address, this is the imbalance, this is one aspect of the imbalance, and unless you address this, ILO reports give very interesting facts about wages and investment and how investment impacts employment generation. And I was reading an article by ILO about the unorganized sector, and it's amazing that the number of people, the expansion of the unorganized sector, even in countries that are not really poor, after the crisis. So, where do we go from here? What we have to look at is evolving new sources of growth and competitive advantage. One of the most misunderstood terms, I think, in economics is competitive. What do we mean by competitive? Now, in order to evolve new sources of growth and in order to evolve new sources of competitive advantage, you require more than an increase in economic growth. And why do we require more than an increase in economic growth? How do I substantiate that fact further? That strategy and policy has taken a rather disembodied view of economic progress by not emphasizing the linkage between growth, employment, and governance. Ultimately, when you view the last two decades, in the preface of my book, I've written that the last, I would say, if not two decades, the last 15 years, definitely, I've described that phase as bubblenomics. And if I may read an excerpt from my book, which speaks about it. The recent economic experience confirms yet again that the basis of growth determines its outcomes. And as an era of bubble-driven economic growth, illustratively termed bubblenomics, comes to an end, it compels us to view the underpinnings of economic growth. Transforming the nature of growth, globalization, and liberalization is essential for most nations in this world, including those who have successful and vibrant economies, those that are struggling to step up progress, and those who can barely manage to keep their financial systems afloat. So, this assumption that growth will automatically translate into development, that however you induce this growth, whatever the employment generation that doesn't take place, however this growth is funded, there would be a process that'll set it all right. I think that has been the wishful assumption that was held on to until 2008, that ultimately, whatever the basis of growth, it will all set itself right, and you would have the desired level of economic progress and economic development. But that didn't happen. So on one hand, you had high levels of growth, and on the other hand, I remember the term, which I found highly objectionable, jobless growth. Now, if growth doesn't create jobs, then that growth is going to peter out. And if growth does not really, if growth is not supported by an improvement in governance, then that growth will also peter out. So, therefore, I use the term bubblenomics. Now, the last 4 or 5 years, as the world has actually recovered from the onslaught of the crisis to a lesser or greater extent, Europe is still recovering. It's very clear that this era of non-inclusive globalization that we've lived through for the last 15 years, that is over. And what we are on the cusp of, what we are actually standing on the brink of, is the next transition from finance-driven globalization to development-led globalization. And it is only when we talk about globalization can be one of the most powerful instrumentalities of development, because the level of interconnectedness that exists today can really spearhead development over a very short period of time. And therefore, development-led globalization will certainly pave the way for sustainable or inclusive globalization. Has this transition started? Well, there is one school of thinking that says it has. There is another school of thinking that says that it will. I'm inclined to think that it will start pretty soon, because there is no other way to go. Now, I remember when we were studying economics, when I was a student at the undergraduate level, our teachers speak about the forecasts which said that at some point, developing countries will catch up with the developed world. The income, the differential between the incomes of the developed world and the developing world would narrow. That has happened in the case of certain developing nations, particularly nations in Southeast Asia, nations in East Asia, and more recently China. You've seen this remarkable narrowing of differentials between per capita incomes in the developed world and in the per capita incomes of these nations. So it is partly true. But what I find even more striking is that whatever it is, whether you talk of the US economy, whether you talk of the Eurozone, whether you talk of Japan, whether you talk of the entire developing world, the need for structural reform. And I think this is essentially a point of convergence, that all countries today require this structural reform. The nature of the structural reform that they require may differ, but definitely they require a faster pace of structural reform. Moreover, anticipating that you're going to have this sustained improvement in investment whatever the stimulus packages that have been given, anticipating that you're going to have the sustained improvement in investment in the developed world and in the developing world without this effort to actually spearhead structural reform, that is being a little unrealistic. You might have some revival, but a sustained improvement and a sustained increase in levels of investment to the levels that are actually required, that will have to come with structural reform. That's not going to come without structural reform. And therefore, when you're talking about potential growth, and as I mentioned a little while ago, when you're talking about increasing the capacity of nations to grow, increasing their potential output, what is required is investment that is targeted towards reducing the macroeconomic vulnerability in the economy, in the global economy. Now, it's important to understand, in order to actually understand the kind of strategies that will work as we make the transition from development-led from finance-driven globalization to development-led globalization, it's important to understand what do we actually mean by non-inclusive globalization? What actually happened to make this process of globalization that we witnessed over the last 20, 25 years non-inclusive? And there were three factors. A, considerable financial innovation has not led to significant financial development. You know, it's interesting, in the course of my research, when I looked at this dichotomy between economic growth and development, it's pretty interesting to note that this dichotomy is essentially the result of three causes of divergence, or three sources of divergence. One was the divergence between financial innovation and financial development. Financial innovation, as it has occurred over the last 10 years, essentially focused on transferring risk and not minimizing risk. That was one of the causes of the financial crisis. That was one of the causes of the kind of slump that financial markets witnessed after the crisis of 2008. That in spite of there being so much of capital, not a fraction of this was actually channeled towards productive investment. And a good part of this was really recycled for speculative purposes. And this entire gamut of financial innovation that was talked a lot about, the purpose of this, all these fancy financial products that were actually brought into the market, securitization some fancy words that were actually coined to describe these instruments which were rather opaque and nebulous. The essential purpose of this was risk transfer and not risk diversification. The products that could have actually spearheaded growth, the products that could have actually led to multiple benefits, not just for the financial sector, but for society, for the real sector, that could have actually empowered those sections of the society that were kept out of the market, and therefore those products that could have actually led to market expansion, this was really not much was done. A little bit was done in the ambit of microfinance, but that was really a trickle compared to what was required. The second point is that rapid technological advancement in certain sectors has not led to significant expansion in innovative capacity. I'm not a technical expert, but from an economist's point of view, and when I think of innovation, innovation is not just technological innovation. Innovation is also, there's a whole chunk of innovation that can be described as non-technological innovation. And even when you look at technology, the capacity for societies, the capacity for regions to absorb technology, to adapt to this technology in a manner that is advantageous, in a manner that is productive and in a manner that will increase productivity, that did not happen on the scale that it could have happened. For instance, information technology, that's the easiest example. Much more could have been done with information technology, and I believe that probably in the next 2 years and 3 years, we'll see work on this front. Much more could have been done in the ambit of information technology to actually empower people who find themselves disadvantaged, who find themselves lacking in information, who find themselves, lacking in access to education and healthcare. So much more that could have been done was not done. And therefore, the benefits of technological advancement, either as a result of lack of skill building or as a result of lack of infrastructure, that really didn't fructify on the scale that it could have. And of course, trade and financial liberalization, one thought, would have spearheaded economic reform. It hasn't. That is, I think, a lever of growth that can easily be tapped, given the level of interconnectedness that the global economy has. And this divergence led to the crisis. It manifested before the crisis, and it was one of the reasons actually that led to the crisis. When we spoke of productivity, as I just mentioned, the main reason for productivity decline, even in the advanced economies, was that once innovations, the benefits from innovation started petering off, and mainly it was information technology, you also had a slowdown in productivity levels. And this slowdown in productivity levels that began to happen a couple of years before 2008, this slowdown was aggravated by the meltdown. Total factor productivity is essentially that part of productivity that is not explained merely by acquiring more labor or acquiring more land or acquiring more capital. That part of productivity that is explained by how all these come together, how technology comes together, and how all inputs, all factors of production are managed. So that part of productivity, just because I have acquired a huge plot of land, I have a huge labor force, does not mean that I have the best technology, does not mean that I'm going to have high levels of productivity. It's how I manage all this that will give me the levels of productivity required. To some extent, what I have at my disposal in terms of land, labor, and capital, yes, that is necessary for me to be productive, but that alone is not enough. And this is an important point, because when we talk about China, as I'll do a little later, when we talk about China, in terms of how it actually manages its inputs, in terms of how it actually manages its factors of production, is not much ahead of India. And that is an area of, in fact, if not weakness, that is an area that China will have to work on, managing its inputs better. This is just talking about the downward trend in total factor productivity that the advanced economies experienced and continue to experience. So this increasing productivity is a challenge across the board. Besides that, you have demographic factors in Europe and Japan, which has led to the shrinking of, because of aging, you have the working age population, the proportion of that shrinking. Over the last 10 years, those developing countries that have progressed maximum have been able to do so basically because of an increase in total factor productivity. And this increase in total factor productivity, and they started out from very low levels of capital accumulation, very low levels of investment. So as capital accumulation increased, as they had access to better technologies, as education levels increased, productivity levels also increased. And this entire debate about growth prospects hinges on, essentially, the structural constraints confronting emerging markets. And productivity in these countries, in the developing world today, how productivity is going to evolve from here will depend on how these structural constraints are addressed. So whether it's in the realm of education, whether it's in the realm of infrastructure building, whether it's in the realm of capacity building, that will determine productivity. And as I've mentioned, it is productivity that was responsible even before the crisis for a number of, for a large extent of economic progress. Now I'll come to the moot point about India and China. When we view China, what comes immediately to mind is the huge jump in growth rates. That for two decades, this country grew at over 9%. Now, what do we attribute this to? That this country was able to get a lot of foreign investment, and this country was able to increase its exports. That's half the story. The other part of the story is that much before actually the FDI export story started emerging from China, a lot of work had been done for about a decade to, in a sense, prepare China for this, what is termed as this controlled liberalization. And it's amazing that in spite of being an authoritarian country, this country at the provincial level has a considerable amount of decentralization. And this is what was actually decentralization in the rural economy, decentralization in agriculture, which began in the 80s. At this point, China's transition is imminent. It has to happen. It has been acknowledged even by the leadership that China's transition from investment and export-led economy to a consumption and services-led economy. If the last three decades saw China's rapid transformation, and China had, during even while it was rapidly transforming itself from a low-income to a middle-income country, there were difficult phases. There was Tiananmen Square. There were a number of difficult phases. But this is a challenge that China is confronted with. Because China, in order to make this transition, has to step up innovation. It has to step up its services sector. And that is an advantage that India has, which India should be doing much more to harness, which China has to actually evolve. Now, here I'd like to talk about economic management. You see, when we are talking about, when I spoke about growth, and I said that growth does not have, a decline in growth does not have to halt development. One of the, and this is in fact an integral aspect of what I did and what was the objective of writing this book and my other books has been the evolution of a development paradigm. And my development paradigm has three constituents to it. One is this effective economic management. The other is what I call P-EPP growth, PEP growth, which is growth that is pro-environment, people, and prosperity. These are, in my development paradigm, two main constituents. And when you're talking about the structural dynamic and you're saying that countries have to work on their structural dynamic, what it actually means is that countries have to improve the way in which capital is managed. There's another factor. Every country has its strengths and weaknesses. And often, when you're talking about certain benefits that are not accounted for and certain costs that are not accounted for, it is necessary for countries to account for practically every strength that they have, however intangible that strength may be. It may be the capacity to evolve certain skills. It may be the capacity to improve management across certain sectors. It may be the capacity to manage their institutions better. So these are intangible. Intangible in that they are not measured precisely, but they need to be worked on because these can be great levers of economic growth. I spoke about PEP growth, and I said that there are three kinds of outcomes that an increase in economic growth results in. One is an increase in economic growth which does not do anything for development. One is an increase in economic growth that results in development. And one is an increase in economic growth which has a regressive impact. Development neutral growth and that growth which has a regressive impact, whether it's 8% or 9%, it really doesn't matter. So, therefore, transforming growth requires accounting for an entire gamut of variables that are described as intangible and qualitative constituents of. Not accounting for this is, if we are unable to, I remember reading an article which said what is not measured is not accounted for. Just because you are unable to precisely measure these variables does not mean that you shouldn't assign emphasis to these. I'll go on to the last bit of my, where EEM is concerned, one of the paragraphs I've said that it's at worst to encounter the scarcity of resources. It's even worse to have resources and not utilize them. Thus, among the most alarming resource constraints that a nation can be confronted is an inadequacy or an absence of EEM. When I speak about EEM, what really comes to mind is Singapore, which had absolutely no natural resources, and at the same time, it has been able to transform itself into a developed country quite rapidly over the last 30 years, mainly and critically because of effective economic management. We know about the importance of India and China. We also know that these are nations that are going to have a great influence on geopolitics, largest markets, fastest growing economies. What happens in these countries, the rate at which per capita income increases, pace at which poverty reduction occurs, that will determine the course of geopolitics in Asia at least. And in the world, it will have a significant, it will exert a significant influence. Cutting through all the differences in India and China, one, it's an interesting similarity that today, both are at a point where reform will decide which way these countries proceed. I mentioned in the case of China, the transition from being investment-led to consumption-driven and services sector-driven. In India and in China, I don't think the problem is one of capital. Essentially, the problem in both countries, in very different ways, is one of what I call the political economy of underdevelopment in India and the political economy of control in China. So whether it's the imperative of institutional reform in China or whether it's the absolutely exigent problem of infrastructure provision in India. These two factors will be driven by the manner in which politics in this country plays out over the next 5 to 10 years. Now in India, essentially when we talk about political economy of underdevelopment, striking a balance between the need for policies that will catalyze the expansion of infrastructure and the interests of those who may be displaced. This is an important issue that needs to be dealt with. Infrastructure provision on one hand and safeguarding the interests of those who may stand to be displaced on the other hand. Now, this is the last bit of my presentation. In China, actually, the problem of institutional reform, the problem of reform is much more complicated than India. Because so far, China has been able to manage its process of liberalization. It's actually managed its market forces to serve itself very advantageously. But its imperatives today, it needs homegrown innovation, it needs a vibrant services sector. Its imperatives today require it to become definitely much more democratic. Now, its understanding of democracy is a little different from our understanding of democracy. But the moot point is that will the leadership be able to retain this incremental approach? It's not that there hasn't been political change in China. There has been, but it has been gradual. And the pace of this political change has been controlled. Will the leadership be able to do it if it wants to serve its imperatives? Because when you're talking about a more innovative society, you're also talking about a society that is much freer intellectually and creatively. So summing up, of course, the challenge confronting China is basically one of changing course and orientation from being an economy driven primarily by numerical to one that is closely aligned to aspiration, freedom, and innovation targets. Where India, I'll say, and this is my last point, that often when we talk about India, we are talking about India's dualism, the fact that India has a traditional versus a modern sector, the fact that it has a rural versus an urban sector. Sometimes it's talked about not as an advantage. I think that economic dualism in India can be a very great advantage, because it is economic dualism that will enable India to actually provide the employment that it requires, and it will ensure India's food security. The moot point here is that economic dualism should not coexist with disparity. If you reduce disparity and if you make available, for instance, to the farming community or to the rural economy, the inputs that they require to expand and become more productive, I think that this dualistic character of India will certainly be an advantage. So to anticipate that, for instance, that even if India, and it's quite likely that it will, emerges as a low-cost manufacturing hub, even if this Make in India is extremely successful, you need a vibrant SME sector, you need a vibrant rural economy. So dualism will definitely not be eliminated as a result of this great stride in manufacturing that India would like to make, needs to make. And even if that stride is made, you will still need your rural economy, you will still need your SMEs, you will still need your micro enterprises. And therefore, when we look at India and China and when we look at the world, it essentially means that we will evaluate economic progress on growth, yes, but more importantly, we need to evaluate economic progress. We need to evaluate economic prospects going ahead on the pace, extent, and nature of reform that occur in countries. And just because you have a 6% growth rate vis-a-vis a 9% growth rate, it does not mean that development should be held back. Thank you.
That was very illuminating. Before we go ahead, I would like to thank our esteemed guests. We'll have a Q&A session after this to the audience for people who have questions about this book and the topic and the rise of India and China and global economies. But before we go ahead, we'd like to thank our speaker for this evening, and Dhaval Desai will do the honors. And of course, our esteemed chair, Mr. Shroff, Aparna Shivakumar, will do the honors. And while we're at it, we'd like to tell you all a little bit about Mr. Shroff. Mr. Shroff is a well-known economist, a financial consultant of great repute, and an ardent promoter of bilateral and multilateral trade between nations, and has held directorial positions in over 35 companies. He has actively participated in Indian economies and corporate development. The Emperor of Japan has conferred upon him the highest civilian order, the Order of the Rising Sun Gold Rays with neck ribbon, for his outstanding contribution in promoting business and friendship with Japan in 2000. He's also been the president of the Bombay Management Association, the All India Manufacturers Organization, the Indo-Japanese Association, and the Bombay Parsi Panchayat, and has played an active role in setting up a fertility clinic for the Parsi community to address the problem of declining numbers among Parsis. Mr. Shroff. So now the house is open for questions for either of our esteemed guests. Yes, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the presentation. I'm Nilesh here from Information Technology of Tata Group, that is Tata Consultancy Services. My question is about the China-led AIIB, the bank. Now, founder members are 57. US was not pushing, and you know, because of World Bank and ADB, Japan-led ADB. Now, because of AIIB participation from Europe, Australia, and many other countries, will it have a financial focal point change? And what would be the impact on overall globalization from your viewpoint?
You know, that's a very good question, and you know, that's an aspect that I didn't touch upon, because as it is, my presentation I think was a bit long, but that is an important aspect. Now, first and foremost, I have to say that in 1997, when, if I don't know how many of you all are aware of the Asian economic crisis that took place, at that time itself, it was agreed that you know, the representation of the developing countries in international finance is far too less than their actual economic contribution to global GDP. But not much was done. There was a lot that was said, and after that, it just settled. Definitely, not just AIIB, but even the BRICS Development Bank, founded by essentially what continues to be developing nations, the BRIC countries, and in the instance of AIIB, China has spearheaded its creation, and it's got a considerable amount of cooperation it would get from the developed world, understandably, because the growth opportunities lie in Asia. And the infrastructure requirement also lies in Asia. And of course, Africa, where China has invested a considerable amount of funds. So there is definitely a need for a development bank. And this is a need long overdue. It should have happened 10 years back. So definitely, if you're looking at it from the financial logistics, I think, yes, it would impact globalization. In that, there would be a greater emphasis given by virtue of the fact that you would, and I'm hoping that the BRICS Development Bank also becomes operational soon, you would have a participation, you would have these global financial institutions essentially representing the requirements of the developing nations. So in that context, it would be an important contribution to development-led globalization. But whether or not China has, you know, China always likes to kill at least five birds with one stone. Whether or not it succeeds is a different issue. I think that, in my opinion, I think China has also done this, because China is very anxious in increasing, besides the economic dimension, besides its economic engagement with the world through its through trade, it's also interested in participating, having a greater say in international affairs. And I think that's one of the reasons it has spearheaded this. But yes, it definitely would have an impact on the way globalization will work.
Yes, ma'am.
Piya, it's very insightful presentation. I am thought provoked to answer to put you to answering two questions. One is total factor productivity that you mentioned. It's very important, and has in Indian economy measurement of India's total factor productivity started or not? If it has to start, how it should start? Because Indian statistics, on and off we hear IIPs are humbugs, GDP numbers have given a lot of bad name, etc. So if total factor productivity measurement, proper one, is in place, other statistics will also get in place and we'll get growth with development, or development with growth. Second point, in view of shortage of time, so that you can answer both together, would like to have your views on present government's approach to FTAs, because that is important part of India globalization.
Very interesting question.
So these two, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Nanda. Nice seeing you. Mrs. Nanda is an eminent economist herself. So, you know, it's interesting that where productivity is concerned, when you look at the infrastructure constraints that India has to cope with, throughout the 90s, a good part of the growth, in fact, not just the 90s, even as India headed towards the 21st century and after that, a good part of India's growth is the result of increase in total factor productivity. And this was enabled by some of the changes, essentially the buildup in the kind of technical expertise that India had, and in the kind of financial, I shouldn't say levels of efficiency, but in the expansive banking sector that it had built. So because of the centers of technical excellence and because of a fairly modern system of banking, you had the capacity to increase productivity. And this was the main reason that India has grown. But now India has, in that context, run out of steam, because however well you manage, you have a chronic shortage of infrastructure at all levels. So in India's case, total productivity is almost being held to ransom because of a lack of infrastructure. And you'll actually see the next productivity jump when infrastructure happens. Now in China's case, the problem is opposite. There you have a huge amount of infrastructure and you have high investment GDP ratios, and they actually need to invest, they actually need to manage their investment much more efficiently. So there they've built the infrastructure, and in fact there they can learn a few lessons from India. So, and if you're looking at productivity statistics, and if you're saying that how would it change, you know, the other statistics, definitely when you have higher investment GDP ratios, that in itself will factor in a higher trend of capital accumulation. And you need this higher trend of capital accumulation because if you recall, from 2004 to 2008, as capital formation increased, growth rates in India also increased, and suddenly there was a slump in capital formation, and then you had the slump in investment. So that's the first answer. The second answer is, I personally don't think that even if you go all over the countryside, except maybe with a few nations, I don't think that FTAs are really going to work much, because we have lived through the era where trade can be the main driver of growth. Not to understate the importance of trade, I think it's very important that India increases its exports. But all over the world, and this is a lesson we learned from China, that China was the biggest exporter, you need to make domestic demand the primary engine of growth. And therefore, you can have FTAs, and that can be a very nice, it can work very well from the point of view of goodwill, but I don't think much will come out of it, unless strategic interests of both nations are taken into account.
Yes, one more, please.
Good evening. I'm studying in GLC here, and I have a two-part question. The first one is regarding your opinion regarding inclusive growth, structural reforms. I want to know, in your opinion, do you think the policies are already existing and there's just a lack of administration of those policies, or do you think we need to develop new policies?
You know, structural reform is something that very little work has been done in India. And I think, for instance, when you talk about has it begun? Well, you know what happens is, you hear about making it easier to do business. you hear about accountability and transparency, you hear about measures afoot to increase accountability, increase transparency, but really not much happens. It happens and you have this a rather halting approach towards this. So I think that what's going to happen now is that it becomes imminently clear that without reducing transaction costs, I mean, if you're going to talk of making India a low-cost manufacturing hub, and particularly in view of the case, you can't be competitive just by reducing your wages, and especially in a country like India, where wages are already so low, you need to look at other avenues of competitiveness. One such avenue is essentially what I call the EEM. One such avenue is managing, you know, this whole gamut of expediency, accountability, and transparency. Seeing that you work fast, the rules are clear, the work gets onto the ground, and you're ready for the next stage. I think that their work is being done, but how fast we are going to see the outcomes crystallize, I don't know. I'm expecting by the end of the year.
Okay, thank you so much. My second question is demographic specific. There's a lot of demographic potential in India, and I'm specifically talking about the women workforce, which is really considerably low. And I have statistics which says that China is comparatively way better than India, as far as that is concerned. So what I need to know from you is what can be done to empower the women workforce in India and make them economically empowered? And also, are there any legislative reforms that can be done compared to China? If there are any such legislations in China which encourage women there to take up working?
You're absolutely right, Jen. The record insofar as gender empowerment in China is concerned is much better. And this was also an extremely patriarchal society. But if you look at the Chinese labor force participation, it's much higher. And what's really sad in the Indian context is that in spite of the fact that most Indian farming households, you know, the women work so much harder, it really doesn't get reflected in labor force, in a higher labor force participation rate. Also, wherever women do work, wherever women do join the labor force, they are paid half of what men are paid. Now, there is wage discrimination in China, but the extent is much less. What can be done? I think it is very important that the legislative reform that takes place takes into account the extent of oppression and exploitation of women in India, whether it's female infanticide, whether it's various forms of abuse. And for instance, criminalizing marital rape. I mean, I think that, for instance, would really be a legislative reform that makes a difference. But I think above legislative reform is social mindsets. You have to change the mindset that, you know, a lady is supposed to endure. She's supposed to endure all forms of exploitation. And in there, I think we can learn lessons from a number of developing countries, not just China, if I may mention even Sri Lanka. That if I am participating in the labor force, if I am getting educated, and education is a very powerful instrument that works against oppression. I read a report in the UNESCO which said that if you're going to have a model of education for women who are below the poverty line, and even those socioeconomic categories that are not that badly off, but where women are exploited, if you're going to say that I'm going to make all these women graduate, it won't work because they won't reach that level. You have to evolve a system of education where after the age of 10 and 11, they start getting vocational training so that by the time they're 18 and 19, they are economically independent. And I think that education and economic independence, that works very effectively to counter oppression. And it is only when they reach that point will they also be able to take advantage of the legislation that they have. I mean, I remember, I'll give you an example to the people. When you talk about the awareness of your rights, most Indian women aren't even aware that they have legislative rights.
Thank you. One last question, sir.
Yeah, last week, the Chinese State Council announced something called Made in China 2025 plan. The crux of it, they have identified some 9 thrust areas. The crux is, they want to move up the ladder, the technological ladder, and do some top-end manufacturing. What are your thoughts on that? The main thought behind that is, from being a factory of the world, if you will, manufacturing powerhouse, they want to be a manufacturing superpower. So there's nothing, none of what you thought is homegrown innovation happening there, at least the focus of their policy. So what are your thoughts
on that? No, I think they may not mention it, but on many instances, they have mentioned that they want to increase the level of domestic innovation. You see, what has happened is, so far, they have essentially been able to develop because of the huge assembly and processing activity of the industry. Now they want to upgrade from there. So they want to get also into the manufacturing of technological intensive products across sectors. Also, they want to step up the pace at which their scientists and their technical experts innovate, because that is not happening in spite of a huge amount of R&D. Now, when the Chinese tell you that I have this target, the super manufacturing, I want to make it the super manufacturing hub, it is understood, if you read between the lines, that that would involve a certain amount of domestic innovation activity. And that is not happening. It is happening at a very gradual pace, because innovation is not something that you can ensure by setting targets. And I think that's the basic challenge that China is going to face. They cannot get up and say that I'm going to give you this much money and tomorrow you innovate. They can't do that, because innovation is idea driven. It's soft power driven. And in a society where freedom is still so curtailed, if not completely repressed as it was earlier, it's curtailed now, how do you innovate? So another thing is, China wants to get, and I think here it's going to attempt to draw many lessons from India. China wants to also, expand its services sector. Now, in order for it to expand its services sector, it also has to have a very different approach. One of the things that it has to do is, it has to give access to credit to all those people who are probably not in any way influential, in the sense that they don't belong to bureaucracy or they don't belong to the state-owned enterprises. And that access to credit, these individuals or these potential entrepreneurs don't get. And therefore, you have the shadow banking and all that. So in order for China to actually become the super manufacturing hub, they'll have to expand their services sector. They'll have to expand the pace at which domestic innovation occurs. They know they cannot do that. They cannot attain their super manufacturing hub dream unless they do this. My point, when I look at the challenges that confront China, I think that those challenges will be difficult to cope. China will be able to surmount these challenges over time, but for them to get outside the mode that, it's about how much money I'm going to allocate and these are the targets, and to get into a more broad-based and democratic mode, how much time that would take, that remains to be seen.
Just a tiny correction, the focus is not on services per se. According to the plan 2025, they want to focus on manufacturing related to services. What's the difference?
You cannot, in China at this point in time, in order to expand manufacturing, like you said, they have to also expand their services sector. And in order for them to expand their services sector, they have to have a very different approach from what they had when they told their factory workers, you work, you assemble, you process, you get the salary, and that's it. If you go, if you went to factories in, when you visit China, and you go to many of the factories, there are, they have a system where the labor, many of them live in the factory. And there are instances where on certain days, if a certain group, a certain cohort is not required, they don't even allow them to come down. Now, you want to expand your services sector, right? You have to have a different approach. So definitely, yes, they will continue with manufacturing, but that manufacturing that they want to achieve, that next level of manufacturing, right, that next vertical that they want to get into, that is also related to how they are going to manage their services sector.
And is there a hidden opportunity for India?
I think that China has always been quite, been quite impressed with India's performance in the services sector. So maybe over the short term, but I think that I personally, over the short and medium term, I'm not going to be very unrealistic about Indo-China economic cooperation. Yes, there are areas, there are sectors in the in certain services, in certain spheres of the services sector where they can cooperate and they can collaborate. But I think you need to have, because we are talking about innovation and we are talking about services, you need to have much more people-to-people contact. You need people to communicate. And only when people communicate, they will say, okay, this is an opportunity that maybe we can work together. So I cannot really say how many hidden opportunities there are for India. But I do know that the main opportunity that India has is that it has achieved remarkable progress in an area that China is just starting out to build.
All right. And for any more questions, the author is available after the talk, so you can always engage with her. We'd like our chair, Mr. Shroff, to give the concluding remarks. Sir.
We will discuss a few points here. China is not going to give India any leeway.
Yeah, absolutely. No,
let's face the realities of life.
Yes.
I've dealt a lot with the Japanese. You know what they do? Japanese don't, I'm so close to them, but it's very difficult to decipher their mind. But what they tell me is the essentials, the nuts and bolts, the innovative part they retain. And it's the more labor intensive, the more humdrum parts are done in China. And now with the strategic interest changing, they're holding back any more investment. In fact, they are withdrawing. So India has come not because of strategic interest, because of sheer compulsion. That is one thing. So in these international institutions, I was just thinking, over 60 years, how much of capital has gone into from multinational institutes to build up? Now all our steel plants, from internal resources and from the capital market. None of our large companies go to them. And what they can give is few million dollars, you require a few billion. China, for the life of them, are not going to help you build up. The other thing is implementation. Our overruns are so huge. Look at our power sector. The power minister says that we are more than self-sufficient. Go outside Bombay and see how many brownouts and blackouts you have. So the delivery is very, very risky. Defense sector. Now you have this outreach programs. You couldn't build up a trainer program, trainer aircraft. Now, all these chaps are watching us, our deficiencies. In Rafale, did we have any choice but to buy the ready-made? From a security point of view, I said, hell with your nationalism. If you want to protect, you see, these are the conflicts. Now, we are talking of women's empowerment. Look at the CARP treatment.
Yes.
Your MPs support it. So if you're not doing it with your daughters, if you're having them killed, so the mindsets have to be changed. Fortunately, the spare the rod and spoil the child, the autocracy in China at that initial stage has also helped. And we need that certain amount of discipline. This vapsis, CAPS, and saying that why should Modi say in this? I think there is not that feeling that the government is serious enough to bring in discipline. The other thing is in innovation, you look at one channel, NKK, Japanese, on the TV. Every day I see that a little turn from our tedious debates on various issues we are involved in. You see some innovation or the other. How robots play with the children. A mother can go away and the robot looks after. Now, these are innovations. What are they? They are responding to this shortage of labor. They're responding to that. They have the same syndrome as we Parsis have, declining, even more so. People don't want to marry. Now, as far as the women participation, look how in the financial sector the women have come. Who have placed them? Not the law. These ladies, five or six, are topping these banks. They've shown by their performance. But now I find in the corporate world, people are only looking for their wives and their sisters and their daughters. I'm telling you honestly, it's nauseating. Many companies have said, give us more time. You can't find a lady to be on your board. The mindset must change. Now, about the disparity, she has given a lot of theory. You've seen Piketty's book. There is the man who got the Nobel Prize and disparities in the world. Disparities are growing. Our press takes the pride that we have so many billionaires.
I'd also like to mention, I'm interrupting.
The billionaires are growing, and not in China. In India, the most galling thing is that in communist systems, where I would like to see at least some equalities, inequalities have grown.
Yes.
The largest buyers of football clubs and properties in London are Russians first and then Indians. The two countries which are not that affluent. Actually, Russia is going down now. Its per capita income is much lower than that of even of China. So the question is that disparities are growing. The mindsets, who wants to do it now? Kaushik Basu, who is the chief economic advisor of the IMF and our chief economic advisor, he wrote a very nice book, I forget the name, where he says the moral is the moral imperative, where cheap people, instead of saying slim, today I read, Mexican who has come to India, $71 billion in Mexico. We have so many billion dollars, and these are not really reported. This is what is reported. You can have your own guess of what is underneath. But the problem is that nobody is going to give away this way. Nobody is going to respond to taxation. Political system, this structural change, everybody knows what's deficient. But I think the major thrust can only come from leadership. You look at a country like Switzerland, or look at a country like, they're not growing now. But the system of well-being, they feel they are happy. They're proud of where they are. And the Chinese are also getting their pride. There are a lot of, for 1.3 billion people, you can't have equality overnight. It will probably take a few generations. But the number of rich Chinese which are getting out. I think some of the good things in India are the skill development. Make people worthy of. We have all grown because of merit, not because of the institutions and so on. In India also, it was very difficult 50 years ago of people not having the right pedigree or the godfather. Even today, it's not all that easy. We know that. But it's growing because merit and people who are coming into the MBAs, the categories, the people who are earning a crore or more, one doesn't envy them. They do it not because of a father or uncle. They are doing it because of their own merit. So I think it's growing. It's the pressure from below. I think so. We are on the right. One thing is there. We are a more democratic and a more forgiving and more caring society. I don't know about the social part of China. It's very difficult to decipher. But Japan is now suffering. They're suffering because the savings, which are the highest in the world, have come down. Why have they been still? When I talk to a Japanese, he doesn't say he's unhappy or his income isn't. How is he surviving with no growth, with no interest? Because the balance in the system. Now, America has a more deficient, despite all the wealth, more deficient welfare system than, say, Europe. So there is this perception is the pressure from the people that I want better welfare. I think at the first phase, you want more money. You want better cars. You want better housing. Problem in China also is for the youth wanting better housing, better cars. They've seen it. You know, it's the perception of living well. Nobody bothers about the neighbor. That comes when you have reached a certain stage of. And I think in Europe, I see that great, much greater harmony, not that extent of greed as it is in the United States, for instance, or in the Arab world. Look at the inequalities in the Arab world. Yes. There a major revolution is going to take place. In 3 years, Saudi is going to go down like hell. And America is not going to beat them by sending troops. They're beating them through oil. There are various strategies and structural things. They won't be theoretical. It's the real world. And no equality is ever going to come. You and I don't like to be equal, do we? We talk of it. We human beings always like a differentiation. It's not because of what you can spend, what statement you can make. You read about these luxury goods today. The smaller towns are having more luxury goods per capita than Bombay or America. Cars, type of cars, the type of consumer instruments. So I think this aspiration level, I have seen this, I have been very much connected with India's best clothing firm, Raymond. A fellow wants a first suit, he'll go to Raymond. Not because it's the best, he can perceives it to be the best. A Mali of mine in Lalai wanted a letter of comfort for a lakh of rupees for a motorbike. I said, why the hell for a motor? You can buy one. No, no, he says, if I buy, I want the best. And I assure you, and he repaid me in 2 years. I was a little scared, but that, you know, it's, and look at the cell phones. I don't change my cell phones as much as I see my staff do. Now, one, from an aspiration from the industrial point of view, look at pollution. We shouldn't have more cars, right? Even the Chinese are conscious. They have the worst pollution. The number of, they have been able, hardly able to contain the number of cars or the type of cars people change. They'll have the largest per capita cars in the next 10 years because they produce them. America is coming down. Europe is coming down. Japan reached that stage 40 years ago. The Japanese production has not gone up at all. American production is coming down. So certainly balancing is taking place. But I think leadership, if you talk to anybody who is a sensible politician here also, he says, where have we got a leader? Of course, Modi seems to be some sort of a bright star on the horizon, and I hope. But he doesn't have that paraphernalia to carry him along. Do they think like him do? I think here the civil society is very poor too.
Yes.
The civil society pressures are not. People think they think of themselves. Cleanliness. The people who dirty the most are they looking of spitting. I know I was with a businessman in Singapore. I told him you'll be fine and you'll have to clean it. He shut it. He didn't only fine him a few thousand dollars, asked him to clean it. I went to Dubai recently and I was told the policemen are paid more than some of the officers. They are in mufti. There are no policemen on the road. But hell be with you if you break the law. So you see, there is respect for law, written law, unwritten law. And I think we civil society have also to display that spirit. Anyway, she has given a lot of thought and I think she has thought a lot ahead of her time because have you seen two things? We have got such eminent economists from the first time I heard Mr. Subramaniam after 6 months is coming here. Mr. Panagriya was writing article after article before he came here. And one never hears of him. He's supposed to be he's devoted. Montek Singh was flying so high. So I think how do we treat people? I don't know whether they'll survive. Rajan is an excellent fellow. He is able to I'll tell you an interesting thing before I end. I introduced him to the Bombay Gymkhana. People came there. The things the committee asked him was, are you going to reduce the rates? And secondly, what would you do if that was just before the BJP came in? So he says, even my wife doesn't know what I'm going to do, nor do my committee members. So I'm not going to tell you. And he says, do you think I'm out of a job? I'm 51. But I'm come here as a matter of, I think I could do something. Now, such stupid things are asked by people, committee members, they are all senior executives or chief executives of companies. I felt so embarrassed.
That is the political economy of underdevelopment.
So I think society, we are trying to raise, but there are a lot of conflicts. And I think we all as individuals have to play our role. I think since it's good, now look at the number of people, amount of preparation, the amount of thoughts, knowledge. How many people are prepared to share or get themselves enlightened? This is the whole tragedy. Anyway, I think for all of those, I didn't expect even so many people. Very nice of you to come up. I myself am greatly educated with some of the insights she has given.
This is Mr. Minushov's sense of humor. You know, when I came in first, there was no one, so I asked Mr. Shroff, you think anyone will come? He said, even if a few come, we can then all sit and have a chat. So anyway, thank you for coming, and I hope you all weren't too bored.
Thank you very much. And we hope to see you at other ORF Mumbai events. Have a good night.